Hello friends, in this video we are going to talk about the basic approach to obstructive jaundice. This is a very important topic both for the undergraduate and the postgraduate exams. So what we are going to do, we are going to start with understanding the basic differential diagnosis, what are the causes of obstructive jaundice, and then we are going to talk about the approach to obstructive jaundice. So let us start with the differential diagnosis of obstructive jaundice. So the differential diagnosis of obstructive jaundice are divided into basically two broad groups. One is the benign causes and second is the malignant causes or neoplastic causes. Now the benign causes for obstructive jaundice which are commonly encountered are choledocholithiasis. Second is a very commonly encountered benign biliary stricture. This can occur after cholecystectomy. Benign biliary stricture which can occur after cholecystectomy, particularly after lab cholecystectomy. Then the third one is Mirisi syndrome, where there is extraluminal compression on the common bile duct due to the stones present in the gallbladder. So Mirisi syndrome. And the fourth is the congenital anomaly, which is known as choledochal cyst. Though choledochal cyst we have kept in the benign condition, this might be a predisposing factor for malignancy of the bile duct. So these are the four benign causes: choledocholithiasis, benign biliary stricture, Mirisi syndrome, and the choledochal cyst. Now let us move on to the malignant causes. The malignant causes for obstructive jaundice, the most common encountered cases are carcinoma, head of pancreas, periampullary carcinoma, cholangiocarcinoma, which is a carcinoma of the bile duct, and number four is gallbladder carcinoma. There are other some rare malignant causes of obstructive jaundice, which can be like metastatic deposits to the portal lymph nodes, as in metastatic colon cancer or even gastric cancer. They can cause deposition in the portal lymph nodes and thereby leading to obstructive jaundice. So these are the differentials that should be kept in mind whenever dealing with a patient of obstructive jaundice: the benign causes and the malignant causes. Now let us see how do we approach a patient of obstructive jaundice. Approach to obstructive jaundice. The basic principle during approach to obstructive jaundice is, the first thing is we should be able to establish the diagnosis of obstructive jaundice. To confirm that patient is having obstructive jaundice, the patient should have a classical history of jaundice with pruritus and pale colored stool. The patient should have a classical triad of jaundice with clay colored stool and pruritus. The clay colored stool is because of the absence of stercobilin in the stool, and the pruritus is because of the deposition of the bile pigments in the dermis of the skin leading to itching. Now how do we establish the diagnosis of obstructive jaundice? We have to take a proper history. If the patient gives a history of jaundice with clay colored stool and pruritus, this is likely to be an obstructive jaundice. At the same time, we should be able to differentiate this obstructive jaundice with other causes of jaundice like hemolytic jaundice and hepatocellular jaundice. And how do we differentiate? There are a few points to be kept in mind. Hemolytic jaundice versus hepatic jaundice versus obstructive jaundice. There are a few points to be considered while differentiating these three types of jaundice. One is the urine color. The color of the urine is usually normal in hemolytic jaundice, whereas in obstructive jaundice, these are usually dark colored. Whereas in hepatic jaundice, this can be variable. The color of the stool, as we discussed, is pale colored or clay colored stool in obstructive jaundice, whereas in hemolytic jaundice, this is usually normal. And this can be variable in hepatic jaundice. And another point we already discussed, that is itching, which is a classical feature of obstructive jaundice due to deposition of the bile salts under the in the dermis. And the last is viral symptoms or prodromal symptoms, which are usually present in hepatic jaundice and absent in the other two types of jaundice. Also, if you take a history of blood transfusion, usually the patient with hemolytic jaundice have history of blood transfusion compared to the other two types of jaundice. So this is a very basic difference that should be kept in mind while dealing with a approach to obstructive jaundice. The first point is, how do we establish the diagnosis of obstructive jaundice? The second point in the approach is to differentiate between benign and malignant causes. as we already know the differentials, and we have the differentials in mind, the benign causes and the malignant causes. So what are the history which differentiates the benign versus the malignant causes? And the reliable history here is usually the benign causes are painful. Like choledocholithiasis is associated with pain. Even Merzbacher syndrome is associated with pain. And they usually have a short duration of history. Whereas in malignant, usually they are painless. And they are associated with symptoms like loss of weight, loss of appetite, asthenia, weakness, and other symptoms of malignancy like asthenia due to cachexia in malignancy. Though a malignant obstructive jaundice may be painful in certain situations, as in where there is compression of the celiac plexus in the advanced stage. Second, there might be pain when there is stretching on the liver capsule. So malignant causes can also be painful at times. So the third step in the approach to obstructive jaundice is we need to localize the site of obstruction of the jaundice. We have to localize the level of obstruction. Now, how do we do that? To localize the level of obstruction, we need to palpate the gallbladder. If the gallbladder, there can be either a palpable gallbladder or we may have a non-palpable gallbladder. So if the gallbladder is palpable, we find whether the gallbladder is hard, irregular, or whether it is firm or tense, smooth. If the gallbladder is hard and irregular, it is likely due to GB cancer. The primary malignancy is within the gallbladder. That is responsible for the obstructive jaundice. If the gallbladder is palpable, but it does not seem to be hard, it is firm, tense, or it is the margins are smooth, it is likely to be due to some cause which is below the cystic duct. And this can be a carcinoma head of pancreas, a cholangiocarcinoma, or periampullary carcinoma. Now, if we don't find the gallbladder palpable, this can be seen as in proximal or hilar cholangiocarcinoma. This is also known as Klatskin tumor. Or this can be seen in conditions like where there is metastasis to the portal lymph nodes, as in gastric cancer or metastatic colon cancer. So these might be the conditions where the cancer is present proximal to the cystic duct, where we don't find any palpable gallbladder. Whereas in conditions where there is distal to the cystic duct, there might be a palpable gallbladder. Now, once we have identified the level of obstruction, the next thing is very significant. The last step in the approach is very significant. We have to establish the subtype of periampullary cancer. Now, this periampullary cancer for an undergraduate might appear to be a cancer rising around the ampulla of Vetter, but for a postgraduate, this is defined as a cancer which is arising 2 centimeters above or below from the ampulla of Vetter. So any cancer which is arising 2 centimeters above and below the ampulla of Vetter is known as a periampullary cancer. To identify whether it's a ampullary cancer or it's a carcinoma head of the pancreas, we have to take a proper history of 2 important points. One is the progression of the jaundice. If the jaundice is progressive, like the patient gives a history of 6 months of jaundice, which is continuously increasing. So if the progressive jaundice is present, then it is usually due to a carcinoma head of pancreas. Or it may be even due to cholangiocarcinoma, distal cholangiocarcinoma. Carcinoma head of pancreas being the most common. Now, if the patient gives a history of waxing and waning jaundice, this is probably due to a ampullary cancer, variety of the periampullary cancer, or for an undergraduate or a periampullary cancer. Now, why does this happen in the ampullary cancer? Because the tumor which is present at the ampulla of Vetter in the duodenum, this tumor gets shed off multiple times due to ischemia. As soon as it sheds off, the jaundice is relieved because the bile can flow now into the duodenum. Again, when the tumor builds up, the ampulla of Vetter gets obstructed again, and again the jaundice starts building up. The next history is melena. Now, when the tumor is shedding off, as in periampullary cancer or an ampullary cancer, along with the waxing waning jaundice, these patients also present with melena, because when the tumor sheds, there is also bleeding into the lumen, and this gives an upper GI bleeding, and so the patient may have melena as well. So just to explain a bit, this is the duodenum and this is the pancreas. If the tumor is arising, this is the duct. If this is the tumor arising from here, ampulla, then at times the tumor gets shed off And when the tumor gets shed off, there is bleeding into the lumen, and this gives rise to upper GI bleeding or melena. And as soon as the tumor is shed off, either due to friction or due to ischemia, then there is release of bile into the duodenum and the jaundice decreases. This is how we classify between the ampullary cancer and carcinoma head of the pancreas. These are the basic steps in the approach to obstructive jaundice. The next thing is we move on to the investigations. Till then, if you find this video useful, stay tuned to this channel for more upcoming videos. Thank you so much for watching this video.